Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Life She Was Given by Ellen Marie Wiseman. Narrated by Lori Gardner. Chapter 1. Lily. July 1931. Blackwood Manor Horse Farm. Dobbins Corner, New York. 9-year-old Lily Blackwood stood in the attic dormer of Blackwood Manor for what felt like the 1,000th time, wishing the window would open so she could smell the outdoors. Tomorrow was her birthday, and she couldn't think of a better present. Sure, Daddy would bring her a new dress and another book when he came home from Pennsylvania. But it had rained earlier, and she wanted to know if the outside air felt different than the inside air. She wondered if raindrops made everything feel soft and cool, the way water did when she took a sponge bath. Or did the outside feel warm and sticky, like the air inside her room? She had asked Mama 100 times to change the window so it would open, and to take the swirly metal off the outside so it would be easier to see out. But as usual, Mama wouldn't listen. If Mama knew Daddy let her play in another part of the attic when she was at church, Daddy would be in big trouble. Even bigger trouble than for teaching her how to read and for giving her a cat on her 3rd birthday. Lily sighed, picked up her telescope off the sill, and put it to her eye. At least it was summertime, and she didn't have to scrape ice off the glass. Daddy called this time of day twilight, and the outside looked painted in only 2 colors, green and blue. The row of pine trees on the other side of the barn, past the fields where the horses played, looked like the felt Lily used for doll blankets. Shadows were everywhere, growing darker by the minute. Lily skimmed the edge of the woods, looking for the deer she saw yesterday. There was the crooked willow tree. There was the rock next to the bush that turned red in the winter. There was the broken log next to the stone fence. There was the... She stopped and swung the telescope back to the fence. Something looked different on the other side of the woods, near the train tracks that cut through the faraway meadow. She took the telescope away from her eye, blinked, then looked through it again and gasped. Air squeaked in her chest, like it always did when she got excited or upset. A string of blue, red, yellow, and green lights, like the ones Daddy put above her bed at Christmas time, hung above a giant glowing house made out of something that looked like cloth. More lights surrounded other houses that looked like fat little ghosts. Lily couldn't make out the words, but there were signs too, with letters lit up by colored bulbs. Flags hung from tall poles, and a line of square yellow lights floated above the railroad tracks. It looked like the windows of a stopped train, a really long one. Lily put down the telescope, waited for her lungs to stop whistling, then went over to her bookcase and pulled out her favorite picture book. She flipped through the pages until she found what she was looking for, a colorful drawing of a striped tent surrounded by wagons, horses, elephants, and clowns. She hurried back to the window to compare the shape of the tent in the book to the glowing house on the other side of the trees. She was right. It was a circus, and she could see it. Normally, the only things outside her window were horses and fields, and Daddy and his helper working on the white fences or yellow horse barn. Sometimes Mama walked across the grass to the barn, her long blonde hair trailing behind her like a veil. Other times, trucks pulled into the barn driveway, and Daddy's helper put horses in and out of trailers or unloaded bags and hay bales. Once, 2 men in baggy clothes, Daddy called them bums, walked up the driveway, and Daddy's helper came out of the barn with a shotgun. If Lily was lucky, deer came out of the woods, or raccoons scurried along the fence toward the feed shed, or a train zoomed along the tracks. and if she put her ear to the window, the chug of the train's engine or the shriek of the whistle came through the glass. But now there was a circus outside her window, a real live circus. For the first time in her life, she was seeing something different that wasn't in a picture book. It made her happy, but a little bit mad at herself, too. If she hadn't been reading all afternoon, she might have seen the train stop to unload. She could have watched the tents go up and caught sight of the elephants and zebras and clowns. Now it was too dark to see anything but lights. She put down the book and counted the boards around the window. Sometimes counting made her feel better. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It didn't help. She couldn't stop thinking about what she'd missed. She pressed her ear against the glass. Maybe she could hear the ringleader's cries or the circus music. The only thing she heard was air squeaking in her chest and her heartbeat going fast. On the windowsill, her cat, Abby, woke up and blinked. Lily wrapped an arm around the orange tabby and pulled her close, burying her nose in the animal's soft fur. Abby was her best friend and the smartest cat in the world. She could stand on her hind legs to give kisses and lift her front paw to shake. She even jumped up on Lily's bed and got down when told. "I bet Mama will go to the circus," Lily said. "She doesn't have to worry about people being afraid of her." The cat purred. What would it be like to see an elephant in person? Lily wondered. What would it feel like to touch its wrinkly skin and look into its big brown eyes? What about riding a pink and white horse on a carousel? Or walking among other people, eating peanuts and cotton candy? What about watching a real live lion perform? As far back as Lily could remember, there had been times at night, after her light was out, when she snuggled in her bed, her mind racing with thoughts of leaving her room and going downstairs. She'd read enough books to know there was more than one floor in a house, and she imagined sneaking across the attic, finding a staircase, making her way through the bottom floors of Blackwood Manor, and walking out the front door. She imagined standing with her feet on the earth, taking a deep breath, and for the first time in her life, smelling something besides old wood, cobwebs, and warm dust. One of her favorite games during Daddy's weekly visits was guessing the different smells on his clothes. Sometimes he smelled like horses and hay. Sometimes shoe polish or smoke. Sometimes baking bread or, what did he call that stuff that was supposed to be a mix of lemons and cedar trees? Cologne? Whatever it was, it smelled good. Daddy had told her about the outside world, and she had read about it in books, but she had no idea how grass felt between her toes or how tree bark felt in her hand. She knew what flowers smelled like because Daddy brought her a bouquet every spring. But she wanted to walk through a field of dandelions and daisies to feel dirt and dew on her bare feet. She wanted to hear birds singing and the sound of the wind. She wanted to feel a breeze and the sun on her skin. She'd read everything she could on plants and animals and could name them all if given the chance. But besides Abby and the mice she saw running along the baseboard in the winter, she'd never seen a real animal up close. Her other favorite game was picking a place in her book of maps and reading everything she could about it, then planning a trip while she fell asleep, deciding what she would do and see when she got there. Her favorite place was Africa, where she pictured herself running with the lions and elephants and giraffes. Sometimes she imagined breaking the dormer window, crawling out on the roof, climbing down the side of the house, and sneaking over to the barn to see the horses. Because from everything she had seen and read, They were her favorite animals. Besides cats, of course. Not only were horses strong and beautiful, but they pulled wagons and sleighs and plows. They let people ride on their backs and could find their way home if they got lost. Daddy said Blackwood Manor's horses were too far away from the attic window to tell who was who, so Lily made up her own names for them. Gypsy, Eagle, Cinnamon, Magic, Chester, Samantha, Molly, and Candy. How she would have loved to get close to them, to touch their manes and ride through the fields on their backs. If only it weren't for those stupid swirly bars outside her window that Mama said were there for her own good. Then she remembered Mama's warning, and as quickly as they started, her dreams turned to nightmares. "The bars are there to protect you," Mama said. "If someone got in, they'd be afraid of you and they'd try to hurt you." When Lily asked why anyone would be afraid of her, Mama said it was because she was a monster, an abomination. Lily didn't know what an abomination was, but it sounded bad. Her shoulders dropped and she sighed in the stillness of her room. There would be no circus for her. Not now, not ever. There would be no getting out of the attic either. The only way she would see the world was through her books. Daddy said the outside world was not as wonderful as she thought, and Lily should be happy she had a warm bed and food to eat. A lot of people didn't have a house or a job, and they had to stand in line for bread and soup. He told her a story about banks and money and some kind of crash, but she didn't understand it, and it didn't make her feel better anyway. She gathered Abby in her arms and sat on her iron bed tucked beneath a wallpapered nook with a rounded ceiling. Her bedside lamp cast long shadows across the plank floor, meaning it would be dark soon and it was time to turn off the light. She didn't want to forget again and have Mama teach her another lesson. Mama had warned her 100 times if anyone saw her light and found her up there, they would take her away and she'd never see her or Daddy or Abby again. But one night last week, Lily started a new book and forgot. She put the cat on the bed and examined the scars on her fingers. Daddy was right, the lotion made them feel better. But oh, how the flame of Mama's lantern had burned. "Spare the rod and spoil the child," Mama said. Lily wanted to ask if the Bible said anything about sparing the fire, but didn't dare. She was supposed to know what the Bible said. "I wonder what Mama would do if she found out I read the books from Daddy instead of that boring old Bible," she asked Abby. The cat rubbed its face on Lily's arm, then curled into a ball and went back to sleep. Lily took the Bible from the nightstand. She didn't dare put it anywhere else. Moved the bookmark in a few pages and set it back down. Mama would check to see how much reading she had done this week, and if the bookmark hadn't moved, Lily would be in big trouble. According to Mama, the Holy Bible and the crucifix on the wall above her bed were the only things she needed to live a happy life. Everything else in the room came from Daddy: the wicker table, set up for a tea party, complete with a lace doily, silver serving tray, and china cups. The matching rocking chair and the teddy bear sitting on the blue padded stool next to her wardrobe. The dollhouse filled with miniature furniture and straight-back dolls. The model farm animals lined up on a shelf above her bookcase, all facing the same way, as if about to break into song. 3 porcelain dolls with lace dresses in a wicker baby pram, one with eyes that opened and closed. And, of course, her bookcase full of books. It seemed for a while like Daddy would give her everything, until she read Snow White and asked for a mirror. Sometimes, in the middle of the night, when she was certain everyone was asleep and there was nothing but blackness outside her window, she turned on her light and studied her reflection in the glass. All she saw was a blurry, ghost-like mask looking back at her, the swirly metal outside coiling across her skin like snakes. She stared at her white reflection and touched her forehead and nose and cheeks, trying to find a growth or a missing part, but nothing stuck out or caved in. When she asked Daddy what was wrong with her, he said she was beautiful to him, and that was all that mattered. But his eyes looked funny when he said it, and she didn't think he was telling the truth. He'd be in big trouble if Mama found out, because Mama said lying was a sin. Good thing Lily would never tell on Daddy. He was the one who taught her how to read and write, and how to add and subtract numbers. He was the one who decorated the walls of her room with rose-covered wallpaper, and brought her new dresses and shoes when she got too big for the old ones. He was the one who brought Abby food and let Lily in the other part of the attic so she could walk and stretch. One time, he even brought up a wind-up record player and tried to teach her the Charleston and tango, but she got too tired and they had to stop. She loved the music and begged him to leave the record player in her room, but he took it back downstairs because Mama would be mad if she found it. Mama brought food and necessities, not presents. She came into Lily's room every morning, except for the times she forgot, with a tray of toast, milk, eggs, sandwiches, apples, and cookies to be eaten over the rest of the day. She brought Lily soap and clean towels. It reminded her to pray before every meal. She stood by the door every night with a ring of keys in her hands and waited for Lily to kneel by her bed to ask the Lord to forgive her sins and to thank him for giving her a mother who took such good care of her. Other than that, Mama never came in her room just to talk or have fun. She never said, "I love you," like Daddy did. Lily would never forget her 7th birthday when her parents argued outside her door. "You're spoiling her with all those presents," Mama said. "It's sinful how much you give her." "It's not hurting anyone," Daddy said. "Nevertheless, we need to stop spending money. Books aren't that expensive." "Maybe not, but what if she starts asking questions? What if she wants to come downstairs or go outside? Are you going to say no?" At first, Daddy didn't say anything, and Lily's heart lifted. Maybe he would take her outside after all. Then he cleared his throat and said, "What else is she supposed to do in there? The least we can do is try to give her a normal birthday. It's not her fault she..." Mama gasped. "It's not her fault? Then whose is it, mine?" "That's not what I was going to say," Daddy said. "It's not anyone's fault. Sometimes these things just happen." "Well, if you had listened to me from the beginning, we wouldn't..." She made a funny noise, like her words got stuck in her throat. "She's still our daughter, Cora. Other than that one thing, she's perfectly normal." "There's nothing normal about what's on the other side of that door," Mama said, her voice cracking. "That's not true," Daddy said. "I talked to Dr. Hillman, and he said, 'Oh, dear Lord, tell me you didn't. How could you betray me like that?'" Mama was crying now. "There, there, my darling. I didn't tell anyone. I was just asking Dr. Hillman if he had ever seen..." Mama's sobs drowned out his words, and her footsteps hurried across the attic. "Darling, wait," Daddy said. The next day, Lily quit praying before every meal, but she had not told Mama that. Since then, she had disobeyed her mother in 100 little ways. Mama said it was wicked to look at her naked body and made Lily close her eyes during her weekly sponge bath until she was old enough to wash herself. Now, Lily looked down at her milk-colored arms and legs when she bathed, examining her thin white torso and pink nipples. She felt ashamed afterward, but she wasn't being bad on purpose. She just wanted to know what made her a monster. The only thing she knew for sure was that her parents looked different than she did. Mama had curly blonde hair and rosy skin. Daddy had a black mustache, black hair, and tan skin. But her skin was powder white. Her long, straight hair, the color and texture of spider webs. It was like God forgot to give her a color. Is that what made her a monster? Or was it something else? Now, hoping she'd be able to see more of the circus tomorrow, she changed into her nightclothes, climbed into bed, and switched off the light. Then she realized Mama hadn't come up to make sure she said her prayers. Lily curled up next to Abby and pulled her close. "She's probably at the circus," she said, closing her eyes. The next night, after Lily first saw the circus outside her window, the rattle of a key in her door startled her awake. She sat up and reached for her bedside lamp, then stopped. Her fingers on the switch. It was the middle of the night, and if Mama saw the light, it would mean big trouble. Maybe Mama had found out she'd spent the entire day watching the circus through her telescope instead of straightening her room and reading the Bible. The circus looked tiny through the end of her telescope, and she couldn't make out every detail. But no matter what Mama did to her, it was worth seeing the elephants and giraffes being taken into the big top. It was worth seeing the crowds of people outside the tents, and the parades of wagons and clowns and costumed performers. It had been the most exciting day of her life, and nothing was going to ruin it. She took her hand away from the lamp and one at a time touched her fingers with her thumbs. 1, 2, 3, 4. The door opened and Mama slipped inside carrying an oil lantern. Lily watched her enter and her belly trembled. Mama never came into her room this late. At the end of the bed, Abby lifted her furry head, surprised to see Mama too. Mama, Daddy said her real name was Coraline, was a tall, pretty woman, and she always wore her long blonde hair pinned back on the sides. Her only jewelry was the wedding band on her left hand, and she dressed in simple skirts with sensible shoes in the name of modesty and for the glory of God. Daddy said Mama put on her best dresses and furs when she went out to important dinners and parties, but only because that was what everyone in the outside world expected. Lily didn't understand why Mama changed what she looked like, but Daddy said that was okay. One time, Daddy showed her a picture of Mama all dressed up, and Lily thought it was someone else. Daddy liked to tell the story of how he had first spotted Mama between the barn and the round pen, sitting on a barrel, watching the horses play in the field. Mama's father, a retired Pentecostal minister who always dreamed of raising horses, had come to Blackwood Manor Horse Farm to buy a stallion. Daddy thought Mama was the prettiest girl he had ever seen, but it was 6 months before she would talk to him, and another 6 before she agreed to have dinner. For some reason, Mama's parents didn't trust Daddy, but eventually, Mama and Daddy were walking hand in hand through the apple orchards. Then they got married. When Daddy got to that part of the story, his face always changed to sad, and he said, "Mama had a hard time growing up." Now, Mama came into Lily's room in a flowery dress and pink heels. Her lips were painted red, and she was wearing a yellow hat. Lily couldn't stop staring. She had never seen Mama dressed like that. Not in person, anyway. Mama's cheeks were flushed, and she was breathing hard, as if she had run up the stairs. Lily's stomach turned over. Daddy was supposed to come back from Pennsylvania tomorrow. He promised birthday presents first thing. But he had told her a long time ago that she didn't need to worry about being left alone when he and Mama went out, because his helper was always downstairs in case someone called about a horse. If something happened to Daddy and Mama, the helper would read a letter in Daddy's desk. He would find Lily in the attic, and he would know what to do. Lily wasn't sure what something was, but she knew it was bad. What if Mama was here to tell her something had happened to Daddy and he wasn't coming back? Lily touched her tongue to each tooth and counted, waiting for Mama to speak. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then Mama smiled. Mama never smiled. "I've got a surprise for you," Mama said. Lily blinked. She didn't know what to say. Daddy brought surprises, not Mama. "Where's Daddy?" she managed. "Get dressed," Mama said. "And hurry up, we don't have much time." Lily pushed back her covers and got out of bed. Abby sat up and stretched her front legs, treading the blanket with her claws. "Is someone coming to see me?" Lily asked Mama. Besides her parents, no one had ever been inside her room. One winter, she got sick and Daddy wanted to call a doctor, but Mama refused because the doctor would take her away and put her someplace. Instead, Daddy spent 3 days wiping Lily's forehead and applying mustard powder and warm dressings to her chest. She would never forget the sad look on his face when she woke up and said, "Daddy, what's someplace?" "It's a hospital for sick people," Daddy said. "But don't worry, you're staying right here with us." Now, Mama watched Lily take her dress from the back of the rocking chair. Lily's legs felt wobbly. What if someone was coming to take her someplace? Mama chuckled. "No, Lily, no one is coming to see you." Lily glanced at Mama, her stomach getting wobbly too. Mama never laughed. Maybe she had been drinking the strange liquid Daddy sometimes brought up to her room in a silver container. Lily didn't know what the drink was, but it made his eyes glassy and gave his breath a funny smell. Sometimes it made him laugh more than usual. What did he call it? Whiskey? No, that was impossible. Mama would never drink whiskey. Drinking alcohol was a sin.
"Why do I have to get dressed, Mama?"
"Because today's your birthday, remember?" Lily frowned. Mama didn't care about birthdays.
"Yes," she managed.
"And I'm sure you saw the circus outside." Lily nodded. "Well, that's where we're going."
Lily stared at Mama, her mouth open. Her legs shook harder, and her arms too. "But what? What if someone sees me?"
Mama smiled again. "Don't worry. Circus performers are used to seeing people like you. And no one else will be there but us. Because against my better judgment, your father insisted on paying the circus owner to put on a special show for you."
Goosebumps popped up on Lily's arms. Something felt bad, but she didn't know what. She glanced at Abby, as if the cat would know the answer. Abby looked back at her with curious eyes.
"Daddy said he wasn't coming back until tomorrow," Lily said.
Mama kept smiling, but her eyes changed. The top half of her face looked like it did when Lily was in big trouble. The bottom half looked like someone Lily had never seen before. "He came home early," Mama said.
"Then where is he?" Lily said. "He always comes to see me first when he gets home."
"He's waiting for us over at the circus. Now hurry up."
"Why didn't he come get me instead of you?"
As soon as the words were out of her mouth, Lily wished she hadn't said them. Mama walked toward her, and her hand rose with a sudden speed. It struck Lily across the jaw, and she fell to the floor. Abby leapt sideways on the bed and crouched next to the wall, her ears back. "You ungrateful spawn of the devil," Mama yelled. "How many times have I told you not to question me?"
"I'm sorry, Mama," Lily cried.
Mama thumped her with the side of her foot. "What did I do to deserve this curse?" she hissed. "Now get on your knees and pray."
"But Mama,"
Lily's sobs were too strong. She couldn't get up, and she could barely breathe. She crawled to her bed with her hair hanging in her face and pulled herself up, air squeaking in her chest. "Bow your head and ask for forgiveness," Mama said. Lily put her hands together beneath her chin and counted her fingers by pressing them against each other. 1, 2, 3, 4. "Oh, Lord," she said, pushing the words out between wheezes. 5, 6, 7, 8. "Please forgive me for questioning my mama and for all the other ways I have made her life so difficult." 9, 10. "I promise to walk the straight and narrow from here on out. Amen."
"Now get dressed," Mama said. "We don't have much time."
Lily got off her knees and put on her undergarments with shaky hands, then took off her nightgown and pulled her play dress on over her head. Her side hurt where Mama kicked her, and snot ran from her nose.
"Not that one," Mama said. "Find something better."
Lily took off the play dress and half walked, half stumbled over to the wardrobe. She pulled out her favorite outfit, a yellow satin dress with a lace collar and ruffled sleeves.
"Is this one all right?" she said, holding up the dress. "That will do. Find your best shoes, too, and brush your hair."
Lily put on the dress and tied the belt behind her back. She brushed her hair. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 strokes. Then sat on the bed to put on her patent leather shoes. Abby edged across the covers and rubbed against Lily's arm. Lily gave her a quick pet, then got up and stood in the middle of the room, her ribs aching and her heart thumping. Mama opened the door and stood back, waiting for Lily to go through it. Lily had waited for this moment her entire life, but now, more than anything, she wanted to stay in the attic. She didn't want to go outside. She didn't want to go to the circus. Her chest grew tighter and tighter. She could barely breathe.
"Let's go," Mama said, her voice hard. "We don't have all night."
Lily wrapped her arms around herself and started toward the door, gulping air into her lungs. Then she stopped and looked back at Abby, who was watching from the foot of her bed.
"That cat will be here when you get back," Mama said. "Now move it."
Chapter 2, Julia. November 1956, Hatfield, Long Island. 18-year-old Julia Blackwood glanced up and down the supermarket aisle to make sure no one was watching. The store was small, maybe 30 feet wide by 40 feet long, and she could see over the shelves and into each corner. A pimple-faced teenager sat on a stool behind the counter, chewing gum and staring at a black-and-white television above the cash register. A radio on a shelf played "Why Do Fools Fall in Love?" while a gray-haired lady checked eggs for cracks next to the open dairy cooler door. Julia took a deep breath, went down on one knee, and pretended to tie her grease-spotted kids. She glanced both ways down the aisle to make sure no one was watching, grabbed a can of Spam off the middle shelf, slipped it into her coat pocket, then straightened and pushed her hair behind her ears. The boy at the counter absently picked at a pimple on his chin, his eyes still glued to the television. Julia let out her breath and made her way to the next aisle, walking slowly and pretending to examine the groceries. She plucked a small apple from a produce bin, put it in her pocket, and made her way toward the counter.
"Can I get a key to the restroom?"
she asked the pimple-faced boy. Still watching television, the boy reached beneath the cash register and handed her a key on a brown rabbit foot. Then he snapped his gum and grinned at her.
"Just replaced the soap this morning."
Heat rose in Julia's cheeks, and she had to fight the urge to leave. The boy knew why she wanted to use the bathroom. It was the fourth time in as many months that there was no water in her room above the liquor store, this time due to frozen pipes instead of an unpaid bill. And she hadn't washed her hair or taken a shower in 3 days. Sure, no one at work would know whether or not she'd had a bath, but who wanted an oily-haired waitress serving them fried eggs and onion-covered burgers? Big Al's diner was already a greasy spoon. It didn't need any more help in that department. Instead of leaving, she swallowed her pride, took the key from the boy, and trudged to the back of the store. The cold, green enameled restroom smelled like rotten food and old socks. Grime and black mold colored the grout between the broken, mismatched floor tiles, and a jagged yellow crack ran across the toilet seat. Julia washed her hands in the silver-legged sink, dried them with brown paper towels, then ate the apple as fast as she could, trying to ignore the stench of old urine. When she was finished, she stripped down to her underwear and bra, folded her cranberry-colored waitress uniform on top of her coat, and put them on the toilet tank lid, the only place that looked halfway clean. Shivering, she scrubbed her face and armpits with paper towels and lava soap, then washed her hair in the sink, trying not to get soaked. The water was ice cold, and the gritty lather made her hair feel like straw, but at least it would be clean. When the last of the soap was out of her hair, she used paper towels to squeeze out the excess water, then got dressed again, combed the tangles out of her hair, put it in a bun, and studied her reflection in the tarnished mirror. The stealthy progress of time since she ran away from home 3 years ago showed in her pronounced cheekbones and the rings under her eyes. Her tanned, smooth skin had turned pale and chalky from too little sleep and too little sun. Even her blonde hair, which was once the white blonde of angel wings, seemed darker and thinner. Her fingernails were chewed to the quick, and her shoulders pointed sharply through the fabric of her uniform. She leaned closer to the mirror to examine the yellow remnants of a bruise around her left eye. Thankfully, it was almost gone. How did you end up in a place like this? Stealing food from an express mart and washing your hair in a public bathroom. You could have waited another year and gone to college, far away from Blackwood Manor. Mother would have paid for everything. Instead, you traded 9 o'clock curfews and Sunday confessions for double shifts and a controlling boyfriend who hits you and spends money faster than either of you can make it. Maybe Mother was right. You aren't going to amount to anything. So what's the point of trying? Mother, with her spite and bony fists, was a rule maker and a rule follower. And she expected the same from everyone around her. Among the countless rules of Blackwood Manor, where certain rooms were kept locked and entire floors were off limits, Julia was to pray 3 times a day, keep her room spotless, do her chores, get perfect grades, and follow the guidelines at school. She could watch her parents' horses from a distance, but wasn't allowed in the barn because it was a business, not a playground. Makeup, poodle skirts, pedal pushers, and tight sweaters were forbidden, and dresses had to be a modest length. Most importantly of all, she had to remember that bad things would happen if she didn't behave. After spending the majority of her life wondering why her parents had her, running away seemed like the solution to everything. Yes, she had been clothed, fed, and had everything of monetary value she needed. But Mother was too busy praying, cleaning, cooking, and making rules to give her any guidance or affection. And her father, who she considered the demonstrative one, only hugged her on Christmas and birthdays. Most of the time, he was in the barn with the horses, or drinking behind the locked doors of his den, with the same scratchy gramophone record, Little White Lies, playing over and over and over. For years, she wondered what it meant when her father went on vacation to recover or get help. It was a strained time, more than usual, a time of keeping going and pretending, of being normal and not fussing. The Blackwoods never bared their souls or poured out their hearts. Then, when Julia turned 12, Mother explained her husband's alcoholism and said it was Julia's fault for being such a difficult child. Julia thought back to the day her father was killed. The sky was clear and blue. The breeze was gentle and scented with pine. Who would have expected someone to die on a beautiful day like that? She had skipped church to go to the lake. It was the last day of summer, a hot, humid day, perfect for swimming, and one of the popular girls had finally invited her to hang out with her and her friends at the isthmus. When it came time to leave for church, Julia locked the door to the bathroom and pretended to be sick. As long as she made it back before Mother returned, everything would be fine. But when Julia came home, there was a police car in the driveway, the early afternoon sun glinting off the chrome and the windshield. Then she saw Mother on the front steps, one hand gripping the balustrade, and her heart sank. Had Julia gotten the time wrong? Had Mother come home early and called the police because she wasn't in her room? Either way, she was in deep trouble. When Mother saw her coming up the driveway, she rushed down the steps and marched toward her, her face contorted in anger, her long skirt twisting around her legs. "Where have you been?" Mother shrieked.
I,
Julia said.
"Speak up, girl."
"I went swimming with some friends. It's the last day before school starts, and they never invited me before. I knew you wouldn't let me go, so..."
Mother slapped her, hard across the face.
Julia's head whipped to the side, and her damp hair flew in her eyes and stuck to her skin.
"I told you something bad would happen if you didn't follow the rules," Mother cried.
Julia put a hand over her cheek, her eyes burning. "What are you talking about? What happened?" Mother reached blindly for the porch railing, her face suddenly gray.
"Your father was..."
Julia started trembling. She had never seen Mother like this.
"My father was what?" she said. "Tell me." "He was in a car crash."
Julia's breath caught.
"Is he okay?"
Mother gaped at her, shaking her head, as if she couldn't believe what she was about to say.
"No, he's not okay. He's dead."
The ground tilted beneath Julia's feet, and her knees nearly buckled. It seemed for an instant that she was falling, but then she realized somehow she had remained upright. In what sounded like slow motion, she heard herself say again,
"What happened?"
"He was looking for you," Mother said. Then her face contorted and changed. The grief in her eyes turned to anger and hate, and her mouth twisted into a sneer. She raised her arms and pounded on Julia's head and shoulders with bony fists.
"It's your fault," she screamed. "It's your fault. It's your fault."
Julia put her arms up to protect herself, but Mother's blows slammed into her head and chest and face, even after she knocked her to the ground. The police pulled Mother off, but not before she split Julia's lip and bruised her cheek and shoulders. That night, Julia stole the tithe money from the canister inside the spice cupboard, ignoring the gaze of Jesus on the decorative tin. Then packed a bag and left Blackwood Manor, vowing never to return. There would be no more early curfews and strict rules, no more nightly prayers and weekly confessions, no more locked rooms, no more blame for her father's drinking. From that day on, she'd be free to do as she pleased. She'd take her future into her own hands, and she'd never let anyone blame her for anything again. Except things hadn't turned out the way she planned. Sure, freedom was fun at first, taking the bus to Long Island and making friends on the boardwalk, pawning her jewelry and moving into an apartment a mile from the beach with Kelly, a cocktail waitress, and Tom, a veteran from the Korean War. The first few months were lost in a haze of music, parties, beer, and marijuana. Then Kelly moved back home. Winter came, the boardwalk closed, and the money ran out. Julia wasn't exactly sure how it happened, but she and Tom moved to a cheap room in the city, and things stopped being fun a long time ago. Tom had trouble keeping a job, and he warned her over and over that something bad would happen if she didn't keep hers. Now she came out of the supermarket bathroom, gave the key on the rabbit foot back to the pimple-faced kid at the cash register, and left the store. Earlier, when she went in, it was snowing, but now it had stopped. The new snow brightened the street. The neighborhood was still seedy, grimy, and litter-strewn, but it didn't look half as bad as it did yesterday without the snow. Big Al's diner sat near the corner, flanked by a liquor store with bars over the windows and a pawn shop with a soggy, ripped carpet in front of the door. Julia buttoned her coat, hunched her shoulders against the cold, and trying to ignore the slush seeping through her keds, made her way toward the diner. She touched the can of Spam in her pocket to make sure it was still there, wishing she'd grabbed something else to go with it. When she got out of work 10 hours from now, Spam on white bread would be her and Tom's supper, like it had been every night for the past 4 days. Today was payday, but her entire check had to go toward rent. Otherwise, they'd be out on the street by the end of the week. When she reached Big Al's diner, she passed the front entrance, went around the corner, and entered the alley behind it. For some reason, Big Al had a thing about the help coming and going through the front door, as if the diner were a fine restaurant instead of a greasy spoon. The smell of bacon and fried potatoes filled the cold air in the alley, and despite the apple she'd eaten earlier, Julia's stomach growled with hunger. A boy in ripped jeans and a white t-shirt dug through the dumpster next to the diner's back steps. Beside him, a thin brown dog sniffed the air, waiting patiently for his owner to find something good. When the dog saw Julia, it wagged its tail and ambled toward her, all feet and ears and fur. Julia bent down to scratch the dog's scruffy head. "Hey, buddy," she said to the dog. Then she straightened and called out to the boy. "You know what Big Al will do if he catches you out here again, Danny." The boy spun around, his eyes wide. "Oh," he breathed, "it's you." He was 9 years old, with hazel eyes and shaggy hair the color of coffee. Julia met him last year when he and his dog were begging for change in front of the pawn shop. "Where's your coat?" she said. Danny shrugged. "My brother needed it." "Your dad out of work again?" Danny nodded. "And Mom's sick." Julia took the Spam out of her pocket. "Here, take this. After my shift, I'll try to stop by with something else." Danny took the Spam, immediately pried off the lid, shook the pressed meat into his hand, and took a big bite. "Thanks." He broke off a hunk and gave it to the dog, who swallowed it whole. "You're welcome," Julia said. "Now get out of here." Danny smiled and ran down the alley, the thin dog at his heels. Julia went up the back steps of the diner, knocked on the entrance, and stepped back to wait. On the other side of the door, footsteps tramped across a tile floor. Someone fumbled with the doorknob, and the door swung open. It was Sheila, one of the other waitresses. "Where have you been?" she whispered. "Your shift started 2 hours ago. Big Al is about ready to fire you." Julia frowned. "What do you mean? I don't work until 10 on Wednesdays." She entered the diner, already taking off her coat. "It's Tuesday," Sheila said. "Shit," Julia said. She hung her coat on a hook, took an apron from the basket outside the walk-in cooler, slipped it over her head, and hurried into the kitchen, tying the apron strings behind her back. Sheila followed. Big Al came through the swinging doors between the kitchen and dining area, his forehead covered in sweat, his greasy salt and pepper hair hanging in his eyes. As his name implied, he was a big man, over 6 feet tall, with wide shoulders and thick legs. But it was his enormous belly that earned him the nickname Big Al. Covered in a greasy white apron, it hung over his pants like a beluga whale. "Look who decided to show up for work today," he snarled.
"Sorry," Julia said. "I thought it was Wednesday."
"And I thought it was my birthday," Big Al said. "That's why I gotta wait tables and cook at the same time."
"I'm sorry," Julia said. "I made a mistake. It won't happen again."
Big Al grunted. "Damn right it won't. I'm holding your paycheck until next week. Maybe by then you'll figure out if you want this job or not."
"But I," Julia said. "Please, Al, I need it for rent."
"Maybe you should have thought about that before coming in late," Big Al said. "Now shut up and get your ass to work."
Julia gritted her teeth and pushed through the swinging doors into the dining area. The counter and nearly every booth were packed. Sheila came out of the kitchen behind her, two plates of eggs and a plate of pancakes balanced in one hand, a plate of French toast in the other.
"Can you cover the counter, hun?" she said to Julia. "Just till the breakfast rush is over."
"Sure," Julia said. She grabbed a pad and pen and scanned the counter for the next customer. A man in a black jacket and fedora sat at the far end. The menu closed in front of him. She started toward him.
"Can I get a refill on my coffee?" someone said as she went by.
"Yes, sir," she said. She put her pen and pad in her apron, grabbed the coffee urn, refilled the man's coffee, then went to wait on the man in the fedora. She turned over a white mug in front of him.
"Coffee?" she said.
"Yep," the man said. Julia filled his cup, set the urn on the counter, and dug her pen and pad out of her apron.
"Miss," someone shouted from the other end of the counter, "where's my pancakes?"
Julia forced a smile. "I'll be right with you." Just then, the bell over the entrance jiggled, and a man in a pinstriped suit and shiny shoes held the door for a woman and a young girl in matching blue coats. The little girl held the woman's hand, and they both smiled as they took a seat in one of the booths. Cold air reddened the identical tips of their noses and the round apples of their cheeks. Julia stared at them, her pen poised above the pad in her hand. "Mother and daughter," she thought. The mother took off her gloves, then smiled and reached across the table to help the girl take off her mittens. The daughter laughed when the mother rubbed her hands between hers to warm them.
"I wonder if it's the little girl's birthday," Julia wondered. "Or maybe they're on a shopping trip."
Then the mother kissed the little girl's fingertips, and Julia's eyes grew moist. She looked for the man in the pinstripe suit, assuming he was the little girl's father. But he stood in the center of the room, skimming the diner as if looking for someone. Maybe he was lost. He didn't look like he belonged in this neighborhood.
"I'll have 2 eggs over easy," the man at the counter in front of her said, "with toast and butter."
Julia blinked and looked down at him, as if she'd forgotten where she was. She shook her head to clear it.
Okay, sorry, coming right up."
She headed toward the kitchen to place the order, berating herself for getting distracted. She had to stop daydreaming. If Big Al caught her staring off into the distance, she'd be fired for sure. But sometimes she just couldn't help it. She was drawn to watching people who clearly loved each other, especially parents and their children. She loved seeing their faces light up with affection and recognition of their unconditional love, and the fact that they knew how important they were to each other without ever saying a word. She wondered what it felt like.
"I asked for ketchup 10 minutes ago," a woman said to Julia as she hurried by.
Julia grabbed a squeeze bottle of ketchup and put it in front of her.
"Where's my bill?" another woman said. "I'll find it," Julia said.
She placed the order on the kitchen turnstile, rang the bell, and asked about the missing pancakes. Big Al pushed a pile of pancakes through the window and wiped his forehead on the back of his arm, glowering at her.
Julia took the hot plate and delivered it to the customer. When she went back to the other end of the counter, the man in the pinstriped suit was there, standing behind the stools. She dropped off the woman's bill and went over to see what he wanted.
"Can I help you?" she said.
"I'm looking for Julia Coraline Blackwood," he said.
Julia's mouth went dry. Is this guy a cop? Is he here to arrest me for stealing from the supermarket?
With a knot in her chest, she smiled.
"She's not working today. Can I give her a message for you?"
The man reached into the breast pocket inside his suit, pulled out a photograph, and turned it around so she could see it. Julia felt the blood drain from her face. It was her high school picture, taken the year she left home. How did he get it, and what did he want?
"I'm a private investigator, Miss Blackwood," the man said, "hired by your parents' attorney." He reached into his pocket again and pulled out an envelope. "I've been searching for you for nearly a year. This is for you."
He handed her the envelope.
"Have a good day."
He tipped his hat and left the diner. Julia stared at the envelope in her shaking hands. Mother had found her. Chapter 3, Lily. Lily stepped out of her attic bedroom, her teeth chattering and her breath wheezing in her chest. She didn't want to go to the circus, especially without Daddy, but she had to do what she was told. Mama followed her out the door, then closed it behind them and started across the room. The light from Mama's oil lamp flickered off an empty bookcase, three broken chairs, and the high walls of the other part of the attic, where Daddy sometimes let Lily play when Mama went to church. Lily wrapped her arms around herself and followed Mama, counting every step, then waited while Mama unlocked another door. Mama opened the door and held it, frowning and glaring at her as if to say, "Move it along." Lily stepped into a part of the attic she had never seen before and hunched her shoulders to make herself smaller. The room felt gigantic, at least four times bigger than the other side, but too close at the same time, as if she were inside a whale with a belly full of fish and boats and rocks, waiting to be crushed and swallowed. She stood trembling in a walkway between piles of dusty boxes and books and trunks. Mama locked the door behind her, then led the way through a rug-lined maze of cobweb-covered dressers, wooden chests, empty picture frames, and broken lamps. A set of rusty bicycles leaned up against a crooked wardrobe, and dirty dishes and books lined grimy stands and shelves. The rugs felt crumbly beneath Lily's shoes. At the far end of the room, a long, narrow hole in the floor opened to a staircase. Mama went down the wooden steps, her lantern light disappearing into the tight space. At the bottom, she stopped in front of a short door and looked up at Lily. Lily couldn't move. She felt like she was going to throw up. "Hang on to the railing and take one step at a time," Mama said. With shaky hands, Lily gripped the railing and lowered her foot over the edge to the first step. She had never walked down a staircase before, and her head felt light and woozy. It was a little bit like stepping down from the stool she used when she was younger to see out the dormer window. But this was a whole row of stools. She felt like she was about to fall forward and tumble down the stairs. She swallowed and glanced down at Mama, who was watching with a scowl. It was either move down the steps or make Mama madder. "Let's go," Mama said. "We don't have all night." Lily put both feet on the first step. One. Then she took another, putting both feet on that step before taking the next. Two, three. Slowly but surely, she made her way to the bottom. When Lily reached the last stair, Mama ducked and went out a short door. Lily followed her into a narrow space, about twice the size of her water closet. On the other end, another door led into another room,
Mama told Lily to wait, then locked the door to the staircase and reached up to pull a red string. A shiny cloth decorated with a house and flower gardens fell over the top half of the door. Then Mama moved a small table with feet that looked like claws beneath the shiny cloth, and like magic, the door disappeared. Mama put her ring of keys in the table drawer and led Lily out into another room with an enormous bed and odd sheet-draped figures. "What is beneath those sheets?" Lily wondered. She stayed close to Mama, fighting the urge to hold onto her arm. But Mama didn't like to be touched, so Lily didn't do it. She wanted to close her eyes, but then she'd trip, and Mama wouldn't like that either. After the bedroom, they went into a long, thin space with shiny floors and walls lined with pictures and decorations. What was it called? Lily tried to remember but couldn't. One side of the space had a swirly metal railing instead of a wall, like the swirly metal bars outside her window. She stayed close to the wall and away from the railing, feeling mixed up and dizzy, like she was going to fall. Everything felt too big, too wide, too long. Her breath rattled in her chest. She touched her thumbs to her fingers and tried to count, but kept losing track of her numbers. She coughed, and Mama gave her a stern look. If she had known the bottom part of the house was going to feel like a giant pit waiting to swallow her whole, she never would have wished to leave her room. She wanted to run back up there now, but that would make Mama really mad. As they made their way toward a staircase with more swirly railings, Mama's lantern reflected off the high ceiling and cast marching shadows above her head, making the walls seem like they were moving. Lily gripped the railing tight in her fists and made her way down the steps, certain she was going to cartwheel and tumble, end over end, to the bottom. On one hand, she wanted to see everything, to explore and inspect every part of Blackwood Manor. On the other, she wanted to close her eyes and make it all go away. At the bottom of the staircase, she followed Mama across an open area with a fireplace, bookshelves that went up to the ceiling, and chairs that looked soft as pillows. The air smelled like soap and wood and metal and dead flowers. Pictures of mountains, people, and horses filled the walls, and a sparkly light made of shiny beads hung from the ceiling. The rug beneath Lily's feet felt as thick as the mattress on her bed. She could hardly believe what she was feeling and seeing and smelling. How could the ceilings be so high, the walls so far apart? What kept such a giant house from falling in on itself? And what did her parents do with all this space? This one room alone could house 20 people. She felt weak and wobbly, like she did when Mama forgot to feed her. More than anything, she wanted to go back upstairs. The world was almost too much. Then she pictured Mama reading a book next to the fancy windows while Daddy smoked by the fireplace, his feet on the footstool. She pictured Mama and Daddy comfortable and warm, drinking hot tea and enjoying each other's company. And for the first time ever, anger at Daddy knotted in her stomach. How could he leave me upstairs? Why didn't he let me come down here when no one else was around? Maybe then I wouldn't be so scared right now. Didn't he care that I was all alone? Tears blurred her vision, but she kept going. There was no other choice. After the fireplace room, she followed Mama down another shadowy walkway with doors on both sides. The light from Mama's lantern filled each open doorway, and Lily craned her neck to see inside the rooms. High shelves and books filled one room, and a long table surrounded by cloth-covered chairs filled another. At the end of the hall, they entered what looked like a kitchen, their footsteps clacking on the black and white tile floor. Copper pots and pans hung over a center counter,
and a black stove sat beneath a stone archway. White cupboards with glass doors lined the blue walls. Above the double sink, a flowered curtain hung over a window made of little squares, with potted plants lining the sill. What Lily imagined were the leftover aromas of cooking and cleaning filled the kitchen. Fried onions and baking bread, water boiling in a kettle, and strong soap. For reasons she didn't understand, she wanted to stay there, to open the cupboards and see what was inside, to soak in the warmth from the stove and eat a meal. It reminded her of the kitchen she had read about in books, where mothers and daughters peeled potatoes and frosted cakes, where entire families sat at tables eating and talking. What was it like to stand at a sink and wash dishes in soapy water? To bake cookies in the oven and make soup on the stove? What was it like to eat with other people? Mama said Lily couldn't eat with her and Daddy because seeing her across the dinner table would make them lose their appetites. Remembering what Mama said made Lily's lungs squeeze shut. All of a sudden, she couldn't breathe. She stopped and gripped the edge of the counter, air squeaking in her chest. Mama glanced back at her. "What are you doing?"
"I don't want to," Lily said between struggling breaths. "Everyone will think I'm a monster. They're going to."
Mama scowled. "I told you, circus performers are used to people like you. Now stop being bad and do what I say. Your father went to a lot of time and expense to surprise you, and I won't have you ruining it." Before Lily could say another word, Mama grabbed her wrist and dragged her into a small room off the kitchen. Coats hung from hooks on the walls, shoes and boots lined the floor, and a door looked like it led outside. Lily counted the boots and shoes, trying to calm down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Little by little, her chest loosened, and she could breathe better. Mama set the lantern on the floor and took a sweater from a hook. She put it on, picked up the lantern, and grabbed the door handle. Then she paused, lifted a jacket from a hook, and handed it to Lily. "Put this on. You might need it later."
"Later?" Lily said.
Mama shook her head. "I mean when we come back." Lily took the jacket and put it on. It felt heavy on her shoulders, and the sleeves hung past her hands. "Roll them up," Mama said. "And hurry, we've got to get over there before it's too late." Lily did as she was told, shivering and sweating at the same time. She wanted to ask what they might be too late for, but couldn't find the right words. Mama pulled open the door and slipped out into the night. Lily stood in the open doorway, holding the jacket tight around herself. This was the moment she had imagined 1,000 times, the moment she had dreamed about nearly every night, the moment she thought would be the happiest of her life. But now, the idea that she was about to walk out of the house shocked her so badly, she felt like she was about to float out of her body into the dark outside. It seemed for an instant that she did, and she could look back and see herself standing in the doorway. "Come on," Mama called over her shoulder. "Hurry up." She kept walking, unaware that Lily had stopped on the threshold. Lily thought about turning around and running back up to her room, but Mama would just come after her, and she would hit her again. That would be worse than going to the circus. Besides, what if she never had this chance again? She took a deep breath, ignored the rattle in her chest, and stepped out of Blackwood Manor. The outdoors felt enormous, bigger than she ever could have imagined, vaster than she ever could have dreamed. She stood shaking, surprised and scared and happy all at the same time. She was outside. A half moon slid down the side of a cloudless sky filled with a million stars, casting a wintry glow over the summer night. And the smells, oh, the smells.
She wasn't sure what wonderful aromas filled the air, but she imagined grass and dirt and trees and water and mud and insects and leaves. She imagined horses and hay and flowers and rain. The thousands of pictures she had pored over in books flashed in her mind, and now she was about to see them in real life. A warm breeze caressed her face. Night felt warm and soft, like breathing under a blanket. She pushed up her sleeves to feel the air on her skin, and moonlight reflected off her white hands and arms. They looked like they belonged to a ghost. Mama kept going, walking fast, and the yellow circle of lantern light moved farther and farther away, bouncing across the grass. On one hand, Lily wanted to know what it felt like to be surrounded by night. On the other, she was terrified by the massive empty space. Who knew what lay beyond the darkness, just feet from where she stood? Who knew if she would be swallowed by blackness or snatched up by a wild animal? She hurried after Mama, counting her steps until she caught up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The feeling of walking and walking and not hitting a wall felt strange and exciting and scary at the same time. Together they crossed the shadowy yard, past the long silhouettes of trees and the towering shape of the barn. Horses whinnied and nickered inside the dark building, thumping against the walls of their stalls. A sweet dry grass smell filled Lily's nostrils, along with a musty warm tang she imagined was manure. Mama opened the gate to one of the pastures, let Lily through, then closed it again. Side by side, they moved across the field. Insects chirped and clicked all around them. Lily wanted to walk slower, but Mama was in a hurry. On the other side of the field, they ducked beneath a white plank fence and made their way toward a line of trees. The ground was rutted and uneven, and Lily kept tripping on clumps of dirt and grass. She was wheezing again, but didn't dare stop to catch her breath. She thought about asking why they didn't take the road, then remembered they couldn't chance being seen. Who knew what would happen if someone saw a white monster on the side of the highway? Following Mama into a stand of evergreen trees, she did her best to keep up. Her shoes, which she only wore when Daddy asked her to, pinched her toes. Sweat broke out on her forehead, and her nose started to run. Inside the trees, Mama led the way along a narrow dirt path padded with pine needles. A clean smell filled the air, like soap and Daddy's cologne. Lily wondered if it was the trees. She thought about asking Mama, but it was all she could do to stay behind her. An owl hooted above her head, and she jumped, then craned her neck to see it and nearly tripped over a rock. When they finally made their way out of the woods, the thinning trees and low bushes, they came out at the grassy edge of another field. From there, Lily could see the dark shapes of circus tents and wagons. The colored lights had been turned off, and the midway was deserted. Mama led her across the grass into a sawdust-carpeted lot, beneath a huge banner that read, "The Barlow Brothers Circus." Overhead, triangle flags hung limp in the warm air. Closed lemonade and hot dog stands lined the lot next to stands with signs that read, "Cotton candy, ice cream, and roasted peanuts." A giant painting of clown faces filled the sky above one tent. The silent clowns stared back at Lily, frozen mid-laugh. Traces of moonlight glinted off flagpoles, making them look silver and old. Purple-black shadows and gray light crisscrossed the grounds, and a strange mixture of hot grease and animal dung filled the air. There was so much to see and smell, it made Lily dizzy.
"Where's Daddy?" she whispered.
Mama shushed her and kept going. Lily scanned the lot, waiting for someone to come running at them through the maze of tents, popcorn, and candy apple stands to ask what they were doing there.
If the circus owner had agreed to put on a show for her, where was everyone? Where were the animals and performers? Why was everything so dark and quiet? When Mama's lantern light swept over a row of giant banners in front of a parade of tents, Lily wanted to close her eyes again. She shrank away from the paintings of scary-looking people below words that read, Aldo the Alligator Man, Lucifer the Devil Baby, Vital the Three-Legged Boy, and Dina the Living Half-Girl. The people in the pictures looked like something out of a nightmare, each one more upsetting than the next. Where are the clowns and the elephants and the horses? She wondered. And where is Daddy? She stopped next to a ticket stand, gasping for air. I want to go home, she said. Mama came back to where she stood, grabbed her wrist, and dragged her forward. Lily tripped and stumbled, but Mama didn't care. Then they came back to a big tent, with poles and beams and wires sticking out in all different directions, like the bones of a giant beast. It was the big top Lily had seen from her attic window. The front flap read, To the Circus, Main Entrance. But the entrance was dark. When Mama passed it and kept going, Lily dug in her heels. Where are we going? She said. Mama ignored her and yanked her forward. On the other side of the big top, a train sat parked on the railroad tracks, a long row of passenger cars and boxcars behind a massive black engine. It was bigger than Lily could have imagined. From her window, trains looked the same size as her model farm animals. Yellow lights shone here and there, behind square windows, and circus wagons with animal cages sat on the ground beside the engine and first few cars. Lily couldn't see inside the cages because it was too dark, but to the left of the wagons, a group of bulky mounds lay on the grass. Elephants, she thought. Real live elephants. 1, 2, 3, 4. Number 4 stood on its thick legs, its trunk hanging down like a giant worm. Lily started toward them, but Mama pulled her in the other direction, toward the back of the big tent, into a cluster of covered trailers, trucks, and wagons, painted with horses and winged lions. Lily tried to get Mama to let go because she was hurting her arm and pulling too hard, but she was no match for Mama. Where are we going? She said again. Where's Daddy? Finally, Mama slowed, and a gloom-shrouded figure moved out from behind one of the trucks and walked toward them. It was a man, quite big, with a thick neck and broad shoulders. Daddy? Lily said. Then the man moved into Mama's lantern light, and Lily screamed. It wasn't Daddy. It was a giant monster with a bony forehead, eyebrows grown together over a wide nose, an ape-like jaw, and a mouth that looked like a steam shovel. The monster had massive shoulders and huge arms, and his boat-sized feet kicked up clouds of dust from the earth. A jagged slit ran up the middle of his face, separating his top lip and splitting his nose into two mangled pieces. In the middle of his forehead, a mass of dark red tissue looked like a third eye. Big gray teeth filled his mouth, crowding one another for space and overlapping at several points. A checkered shirt stretched over his muscled chest, and the bottom of his worn trousers stopped.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.